Okay, welcome back as we start wrapping things up in this conclusion, putting things together of our video series on drift away. And one of the things we want to look at is where we left off last time with Jude 20. We focused on this, keep yourselves in the love of God. Now, hopefully what you can draw from this verse and then the next verse is this paradigm that oftentimes people make a mistake in thinking there are issues in the Bible that are either black or white, or in the sense of A or B. And the idea here is that there's oftentimes, as majestic as the text is, there are multiple ways in order to read and understand the text, and the authors leave clues. The biblical authors leave clues, and the Holy Spirit leaves us these inferences that we can make. So, obviously, if you watched all five of the previous videos, you might think that I'm against eternal security. It depends on what you mean by eternal security, because I'm trying to show those who hold that position that there are passages where one has to do something. So our salvation is secure. We can't lose it because of sin, but we still have obligations to reciprocate in God's grace certain things he's doing. I'm reminded of Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, where it says that God took the dirt, the mud, and he breathed in the breath of life into what becomes Adam, humanity. Okay? So think of it as breathing. Breathing in the breath, the life of God. We are but mud, we are but dust, we are but clay, and we return to dust or mud or clay. So from the place we're taken, Sheol, in a sense, outside the earth below, we return when we die and we're buried and we're put back where we came from. But that dirt receives the life of God conceptually and breathes it in. So it's an inhaling. And then what is our response? Our response is reciprocate the life that's given to us, the gift of God given to us. We reciprocate that out by breathing out. And it's this constant thing of breathing in and breathing out. And that's the paradigm I want you to see here. And so when we talk about in Jude 20, where it says, by the Holy Spirit, okay, number one, we said, build yourselves up. So there's something you must do as a believer by the author of Jude, by the scriptures, by the Holy Spirit, that you must build yourself up in your most holy faith, and you must pray in the Holy Spirit. So think of it this way. Again, that spirit, okay? In the beginning, God. Then in the New Testament, Jesus comes in the incarnation, but then he ascends on high. And he sends down the Holy Spirit. And in several places, we have this, especially in Romans 8, which is a key passage for most people. We have this idea that Jesus is up there in Romans 8, 34, I think. Jesus is up there interceding and praying to the Father on our behalf. He's that mediator between humanity and God, but he's up there as a man interceding for us. Yet at the same time, earlier in Romans chapter 8, verse 26, the Holy Spirit is down here inside the body of Christ in the temple, the Spirit's temple, praying also. And so you have this idea of heaven and earth coming together. You have everything that you see in the book of Revelation chapter 4 and 5, everything you see going on with the myriads and myriads surrounding the throne going on, and Jesus is up there with the Father, and he is in that environment. And yet the Holy Spirit then down here joins in that environment, participates in that environment. And then the believer, being the temple of the Holy Spirit, being the body of Christ, being a follower, can experience what's called in many traditions in Christianity called theosis, okay, which is ultimately what we've been talking about in these video series. So theosis is experienced, where we become like God in the sense that we glorify God. So it's a participation or precipitatory model here. So there are things that we must do to reciprocate. So we keep ourselves in the love of God as we wait for Jesus who's coming. So we have the kingdom now, and we're trying to bring as much of that kingdom in the now as we can until we get to the not yet. And all of this is going to lead us to eternal life. And so remember what we're dealing with here in Jude 20 is to keep yourself in the love of God as we wait for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ that leads to eternal life. Okay. So we talked about what we're supposed to do there, but the focus is on that we need to do something. It's, you know, it's not works righteousness necessarily. We get into that. It's righteousness that works. And then how we turn to verse 20 in the same passage, the Holy Spirit, by the Apostle Jude, can speak to us and say that God is the one who keeps you. And so it's both and. God keeps us, eternal security, but then we at the same time must participate in what God's doing. So it's a both and paradigm here. Now, we could continue this understanding when we look at Paul in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 11 to 12, where he also continues this idea in that we must take hold of eternal life. And I want to look at that again in the ISV. But you, man of God, must flee. Okay? You must do something. You must flee from all these things. You must leave them. So it's kind of like a reverse. When Adam and Eve were kicked out of the Garden of Eden, now they're leaving these things. And instead, you must pursue righteousness, godliness, and the following. Faithfulness. Okay, God is faithful. We must be faithful. So right here in 1 Timothy, Paul sets up this idea then of a parallel. On one instance, the believer must flee from the things of this world. At the same time, and again, he's writing to Timothy. He's writing to matured believers. The Bible is written to believers primarily. The Bible speaks of many sins, but it's the believers that are in danger of committing these sins. And it's the believers who must flee from all these things because it's possible for the believers not to. And instead, you must pursue righteousness, godliness, faithfulness, love, endurance, and gentleness. So it's something the believer must do. Now, interesting, he says, fight the good fight for the faith. Fight. Now, in the Old Testament, there's this idea of the divine warrior that the New Testament then lays that over the top of Jesus. In Revelation 19, Jesus comes with the armies of heaven. And the Old Testament is believed that God, the divine warrior, would come with the armies of heaven, but also God's people and the Israelites, like Joshua in the conquest or Moses before that, participate in the battle as well. And so it's a both and battle in the supernatural and on earth. Heaven and earth are both fighting in this. And so it's participatory. So we have this language here of that you must, he's commanding, you must fight. For the faith. Faith has to be fought. It's a battle. It's not just sitting back and doing nothing. Once saved, always saved. It requires some activity. And then interestingly, notice how the ISV renders the Greek here, trying to capture the what's behind the grammar. And that's why it's always good to look at different English translations. And then if you can, use some software like Logos Bible software that has a reverse interlinear to get you underneath the text, get you behind the grammar, as we're showing you in all these videos that you can do to get to the original languages as much as possible. So notice how the ISV renders this. Keep holding on to eternal life. It's not something you just, that's it. Remember, we're talking about believes from John 3:16. So this is something whereby we must keep holding on to, which means obviously that you can stop holding on to. So continually keep holding on to eternal life. It's a both and thing. You're being held by God, but you're also holding on to God. Paul says that in Philippians chapter 3, after he gives his resume of how great he was as a Jew and Pharisee, then he says, I count it all as rubbish. I'm trying to grab a hold of that which is holding me. I'm trying to gain that. God came in Jesus and left his spirit here to get me, to seize me on the road of Damascus. And now I want to grab everything that I can to bring his kingdom as much as possible now so that it can come. And Paul thought it was coming in his day as much as his earthly wisdom allowed him to. He firmly believed that the second coming of Christ was going to happen in his day. And it's the way prophecy works in rhythms, how it unfolds. It's almost like a song. The book of Revelation is a song, where you have verse, you know, the stanzas and then the choruses, and you keep repeating the same notes over and over again, like the chords in most Christian songs today are the chord of G, the chord of C, the chord of D, and then it's repeated G, C, D. You have that idea where you have a verse or stanza, and then you go to the chorus, and it's the same thing, and then back to the verse, and then chorus, and back to the verse. And so we have this unfolding of biblical prophecy where there are fulfillments in the Old Testament itself, fulfillments in the New Testament itself, fulfillments in the near first century, and then on through history. It just keeps repeating those patterns over and over again. As they argue in the patterns and rhythms in the Pentateuch, they just keep repeating themselves throughout. Okay? So we have this participatory language again in 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 and 4, his divine power. Remember, it's his power. It's not ours. It's his power that grants us all things that pertain to both life and godliness through the knowledge of him who's called us by his own glory and excellence. It's his glory. It's his excellence where we empty ourselves out, like Philippians chapter 2, where we empty ourselves out and through the kenosis language there in the Greek, we empty ourselves out just as Christ did. And then we are full of his spirit and we allow his own glory and his excellence, his kingdom to rule our individual life and tame our individual chaos. And then we begin to work with taming the chaos individually in our families till we can branch out into other social aspects like our fellowships and churches, our communities, and our own places where we live. And then we just keep branching out from our Jerusalem, our Judea, our Samaria to the other ends of the earth, by which he has granted to us his precious and very great promises, so that through them, through these promises, you may become partakers of the divine nature. See how we partake in the divine nature. Having escaped, remember, 1 Timothy 6, we're fleeing from the corruption that is in this world because of sinful desire, and we're partaking of the divine nature, and we're allowing God's rule to rule our own life through our own constant moment by moment surrendering to his will and the desire of the Holy Spirit to use us as a vessel to bring that glory, to fill the earth, to bring that excellence. As there is no one like Yahweh, then there is no one like those who follow him. So we continue in this idea. Look at Ephesians chapter 2, verses 8, 9, and 10. And we have to be careful of taking one verse out of context, and we have to look at the entire verse in its context and then place it in the context of the rest of the literature that surrounds it. This is a very famous verse. For grace, by grace you have been saved through faith. By grace, grace. What do we understand God's grace as has been argued by De Silva using Seneca and picked up by other scholars who have gone on to say that this is gift. Okay, and we have Barclay has written one of the most definitive works on Paul in the last generation, recently called Paul and the Gift, using what De Silva found in Seneca, in the first century Greco-Roman world, to understand grace's gift. Again, you can see that in my embodied justice paper, and I have a video out on embodied justice, understanding grace. But we always talk about how the grace, the gift, that where God breathes his life into us, and it's his life that we return back to him as a gift. So what he gives us, we give back to him, and it's just wonderful imagery of how God continues to pass that to us, and we give it back to him, just like the air we breathe. You have been saved. Have been saved. This is where people take this one verse and take it out of context. When Paul in other places says, you are being saved, in 1 Corinthians 15, and then later on he says, you will be saved. So it's a constant, continuous process. But everyone goes to this one verse and automatically assumes that there's this idea that you are already saved and that's it. And of course, it's through faith. And some people have talked about how this also can be translated and understood as faithfulness that we just read in the previous verses about faithfulness. And if you continue in 2 Peter, you'll see that's a part of it as well in that context. And we've already visited 2 Peter chapter 1 before, and we just revisited in these videos, so you can dig that out, dig the commentaries out, go through that and see what's going on. And this is not your own doing. Remember, again, it's the power of God. All we're doing is surrendering to the Holy Spirit and the work of God in our lives and letting God's reign. Remember, it's the kingdom of God here on and in earth as it is in heaven. Life is God's life. It's not my own. I don't belong to. Paul described it as we showed in earlier videos. You're either slave to sin or slave to righteousness, but you and I, we are servants, either one. And we decide which is going to control us. Okay, and again, here's that gift language. It is the gift of God. God, like he breathed into that mud. It's the gift of God. And they say, not a result of works. It's not your works. You don't earn this. It's a gift. And that's true. And so we get that. And so we dig into this. But amazingly, right here in this context, it's not a result of your works, but it's not your own doing. But see how this, let's go back through this again, not your own doing. So going back, it's grace. You've been saved by God through faith, through his faith and your faith, participating in one another and becoming both. You reflect the faithfulness of God. This is not your doing. Remember, it's not your doing it. It's his doing it. It is the gift of God. So it keeps going back and forth between God and the believer. Not the result of your works. So not your doing, not your works. It is the gift of God. It's by grace. For we are his workmanship. Again, it's his work. It's his power. As we saw in Romans 11, it's his power at work. And we're going to continue to see that in the videos as we go on. We're a new creation in Christ Jesus. For what reason? So that we can then do good works. So it goes back to us again. It's just breathing in, breathing out. It's just going from God to us and back to God to us, back to God to us. It's just constant going back and forth where it's we participate in God's work so that we can do the works that God prepared. Again, it goes back to God. It's God doing this through us beforehand. Okay, God planned this, and we talked about that in the promise videos, that we should what? That we should walk in them. So as we continue going through, and this is not the final video, but this is a setup for what is to follow as we continue to track this language through the New Testament and tie the entire biblical theological message together so that we understand that we have works, workmanship, works, all in the same context. And many people, again, misconstrue this as works righteousness in some sense in Galatians. But what Paul is getting at is a righteousness that actually works and is effective. As there is no one like Yahweh, there's no one like us. And we walk like Enoch and Noah walked, like Adam walked. How the biblical theological messaging is these people walked with God. We walk with him in that Torah, that charter for humanity from 2 Samuel chapter 7, verse 19. We walk in that. And we become the very promise of God. And when people see that, it's like Abraham. They were jealous of what Abraham had. They'll be jealous of what we have. And therefore, they'll want what we got because they don't have it. Because theirs does not work and ours does. Because as there's no one like Yahweh, as there's no one like Jesus, no other human has been like Jesus, there are no one like those who follow him, the Christians who are like Christ.